We are in our third module. Syllabus is given, formability of soils and principle of effective stress. So we shall discuss effective stress. An overview of the PPT is given. We will be watching the soil skeleton and the stresses in soil, types of soil, water, and most importantly, effective stress principle and the stress due to self-weight in a layered soil also, and the effect of surcharge. And also we'll see the effect of water table on effective stress. Soil skeleton. We can visualize soil as a skeleton of solid particles enclosing continuous voids, and the voids may contain either water or air. So the volume of soil skeleton can be changed due to rearrangement of soil particles. And water is considered to be incompressible in a fully saturated soil. So in such case, a reduction in volume is possible only if some of the water can escape from the voids. And in a partially saturated or a dry soil, this reduction in volume is possible due to compression of the air in the voids. So stresses in soil, how to find stress in a soil at any particular point? So it is occurring due to the soil lying above the point where we are considering the stress. Or it may be due to any other imposed load on soil mass. So stress in a soil at a point, at any point, is a result of the soil lying above that point and by any other imposed load on the soil mass. So if there is any imposed load coming on that, it will also cause some stress in the soil at that particular point where we are considering. Then study of soil mechanics helps to predict the stresses and strains imposed at any given point on a soil mass due to certain loading conditions. And why should we study these stresses? So this will help us to estimate settlement, to conduct stability analysis of earth and earth retaining structures, and also if we know the stress conditions on underground and earth retaining structures, they can be designed accordingly. So now coming to the different types of soil water. So broad classification is like free water and held water. Free water is also known as gravitational water. So that type of water can move in the pores of the soil under the influence of gravitational force. So it can flow from one point to another where there is a difference of total head, or if there is any difference in total pressure, it can flow from one point to another, and the flow is like laminar flow. And about held water, it is a water retained in the pores of the soil, and this water cannot move under the influence of gravitational force. And they are of three types: structural water, adsorbed water, and capillary water. Now we'll see structural water. So it is a chemically combined water in the crystal structure of the soil mineral. This water cannot be removed without breaking the structure of the mineral. And adsorbed water, what is it? It is the water held by electrochemical forces existing on the soil surface. And it is important for clay soils and for coarse grained soils. This type of water can be neglected. And it is also known as hygroscopic water in the case of air dried soils. Then capillary water. It is a water held in the interstices or voids of the soil due to capillary forces. It exists in soil with an air-water interface. And if the soil is submerged under water, the interface is destroyed and the capillary water becomes normal free water. So next important term is pore water. So this pore water, it is a free water and the capillary water together called pore water. Pore water is free of strong soil attractive forces. Now coming to the important topic, effective stress principle. This is very important. So it can be stated as two, like what is effective stress and how it is influencing the soil engineering properties. So effective stress, it can be denoted by sigma dash. It will be different in different textbooks. I'm denoted like sigma dash or sigma bar or whatever. Effective stress at a point in a soil mass is equal to the total stress sigma at that point minus the pore water pressure U at that location. So sigma dash is equal to sigma minus U. Sigma is the total stress at that point and U is the pore water pressure at that location. So if you want to find out the effective stress at a point in a soil mass, you have to find out the total stress sigma and the pore water pressure U and take the difference. So it can be expressed as an equation, sigma bar is equal to sigma minus U. And this effective stress controls the engineering properties of soils, mainly compressibility or the change in volume and shear strength. So these are the two important points in effective stress principle. And you can write also the corresponding terms, like explain the corresponding terms, total stress sigma and what is pore water pressure U. So what is this total vertical stress sigma? So sigma at a point is the sum of weight of all the material, whether it is solid or water, all the material above the point per unit area. So it is simply mass into gravitational constant of all the material. Weight of the sum of weight of all the material coming above that point. That will give you the total vertical stress sigma. And what is this pore water pressure? It is a pressure due to water in the void spaces or pores which are existing between and around the soil grains. So pore water pressure is a pressure due to water in pores which are existing or which are seen between and around the soil grains. It is also known as neutral pressure or neutral stress. So if the water is not flowing under no flow conditions, how to find out the pore water pressure? It is simply given by the hydrostatic pressure. That is U is equal to gamma W into H. What is H? H is the depth of that point from the top. Or the depth of that point, and gamma W is the unit weight of water. So if there is no flow occurring, if it is a no flow condition, then pore water pressure is given by the hydrostatic pressure gamma W into H. So this effective stress principle was developed by Karl Tersaghi in 1936 and it is a basis of most important theories in soil engineering. This theory is valid only for, this principle is valid only for saturated soils. So we told that effective stress can be found by taking the difference between total stress and the pore water pressure. So both total stress and pore water pressure are physically measurable. Total stress can be measured with a pressure cell and pore water pressure can be measured with a piezometer or standpipe. So this effective stress cannot be measured. It is not a physical parameter. It is mathematically calculated. So before I had told, pore water pressure is also called neutral stress. Why it is called neutral stress? Because it acts on all sides of the particles but does not cause the soil particle to press against adjacent particles. It has no shear component. So that's why it's called neutral stress. So in other words, if the pores of a soil mass are filled with water and if a pressure is induced into the pore water that tries to separate the grains, this pressure is termed as pore water pressure or neutral stress. So we can see the stress due to self weight. How to find out the stress due to self weight? The vertical stress on element A. The element A is marked yellow in the left hand side figure. Can be determined. The vertical stress on element A can be determined simply from the mass of the overlying material. So how to find out the mass of the overlying material? And if gamma represents the unit weight of the soil, then the vertical stress is gamma into Z. Z is the depth of that point from the top and gamma is the unit weight. So the stress, vertical stress at point A is equal to gamma into Z. And what is the vertical stress at any point on the ground surface? At the top, if the point we consider is at the top, what will be the vertical stress? What is the mass of the particle above that point? So above that point it will be 0. There is no mass supported above that point if you are considering a point at the top surface. So the value is 0. So if you draw the variation of stresses with depth, you will get a triangle like this on the right hand side. So at the top point, the stress is 0, and at the bottom point, that point is A. We have marked it as point A. So at the point A, what is the vertical stress? It is gamma into Z. Now consider the same land surface with some surcharge over that. So the original land surface is given an additional layer of soil above it to make it into a conversion land surface, maybe to make a road or something like that. So let the unit weight of the soil used as surcharge be gamma itself. Now we can consider three points, one above the conversion land surface, one above the original land surface, and one at the bottommost of the original land surface. So at the topmost point of the conversion land surface, what will be the value of vertical stress? So vertical stress at a point is due to the mass of soil above that, isn't it? So above the conversion land surface, there is nothing. So the value of stress is 0. So on the right hand side, if you draw a stress variation diagram, the topmost value is 0. It is marked with a green color dot. Now consider the original land surface, top of the original land surface. A point is marked in red color, red dot. So at that point, what will be the total vertical stress? Total stress. What will be that? It is due to the mass of the soil above that. So let the stress be Q. So it is equal to gamma into H. H is the depth of the surcharge. And what about the bottommost point? Let that point be at a depth of Z from the top of the original land surface. So what is the stress at that point? It is due to a layer of soil of depth Z and a layer of surcharge of depth H. So sigma Z is equal to gamma into Z plus the Q value. Q is how much? Gamma into H. Now, how will be the stresses in a layer deposit? So in layer deposit, each layer will be having different gamma values. Suppose there are three layers of soil with gamma 1, gamma 2 and gamma 3 value, different unit weights, and they are for a depth h1, h2 and h3. So z1, z2 and z3 are the depth of each layer from the top. Okay, z1 is the depth of layer, first layer from the top. Z2 is the depth of the bottommost point of the second layer from the top, like that. So how will be the stresses? So what will be the stress at the topmost point? So four points are marked with red as red dots. So the first point is at the topmost. So the stress there will be 0. And what will be the stress at the second point? It is at a depth of H1, and it is having a layer of soil of gamma 1 above it. So what will be the stress? So the first green line on the right hand side, that is, what is the stress at the point at a depth of z1? It is gamma 1 into h1. Now similarly, what is the stress at the third point, at the level of the third point? That means in the second layer of unit weight gamma 2, what will be that due to gamma 1 and gamma 2, two layers of soil are above it. So it is gamma 1 into h1 plus gamma 2 into h2. Now what is the stress at the bottommost point? It is gamma 1 into h1 plus gamma 2 into h2 plus gamma 3 into h3. Thank you. So now discussing about the water table. So if what is the effect of water table on this stresses? So now we have considered only the layer of soil. So now if the water table is coming in between, what is the effect of that? So what is water table? It is a natural static water level in the ground at which water pressure head is same as the atmospheric pressure. That is called the water table. Magnitude of pore water pressure at the water table is zero, and below the water table pore water pressure will be having positive values. And it is also called groundwater level or free water surface or phreatic surface. It can rise or deplete. At different layers it will be at different levels. At different places it will be at different levels. So below the water table, most of the soils are taken as saturated and all the voids will be filled with water. And above the water table, it becomes partially saturated. It may be partially saturated or not. And that degree of saturation will be depending upon climatic conditions, particle size and distance to the water table. So the particle size has a prominent effect. Clay particles, even if it is above water table, it is usually remaining as saturated, but coarse grained soils remains dry, and that is due to capillary effect. So water table is denoted by WT, and there is a symbol to denote the water table also. Notation it's given. Now we'll see how the water table is affecting the stress. So what is the effective stress? If there is water inside the soil, what is the effective stress? What is the effective stress principle say? Effective stress is equal to total stress minus pore water pressure. Now look at the figure. Soil mass is there, and above the soil mass some water layer, some water is there. Okay, so water table is coming over the soil mass. So we will consider two points A and B. It is marked in the figure. So how will be the stress at point A? So now there is water table coming to the scene, coming to the scenario. So we have to consider the effect of pore water pressure. So consider the point A. What will be the stress at the point A? So in order to find out the total stress, we have to consider, in order to find out the effective stress, we have to consider the total stress and the pore water pressure. So what is the total stress at the point A? It is due to the weight of the particle above it. Weight of particle. So what is above that point A? Only water. So sigma A, total stress at point A, sigma A is equal to gamma W into H1. H1 is the height of water and gamma W is the unit weight of water. Now what is the pore water pressure? It is again UA is equal to how much is the unit weight of water and how much is the depth of water over that layer. In the same, it is gamma W into H1. So what is the effective stress? It is sigma bar is equal to sigma A minus UA. Sigma at point A minus pore water pressure at point A, which is equal to 0. Gamma WH1 minus gamma WH1, it is 0. Now consider the point B, which is at the bottom of the soil layer. What is the total stress and what is the pore water pressure? Mathematically, what is the effective stress? So total stress sigma B, what is that? It is gamma W into H1 plus gamma saturated into H2. So the soil layer is saturated with water. Water table is coming above it, so it is saturated. So we have to take the saturated, gamma saturated value. So what is the weight of the water? Gamma W into H1 plus gamma saturated into H2. Then what is the pore water pressure? Pore water pressure is H1 plus H2 into gamma of water. Now we can find out the effective stress. It is taking the difference. So if you take the difference, you will get gamma W H1 plus gamma 2 into gamma H2 into gamma saturated minus H1 plus H2 into gamma W. So you will get H2 into gamma submerged. Gamma submerged is equal to gamma saturated minus gamma W. So if you are substituting that in this equation, you will get sigma dash is equal to H2 into gamma submerged. This is how we have to find the effective stress, where some water table is coming. This is somewhat real case. Water table will be there, so the effect should be considered. Now coming to an example, the soil profile is shown in this figure. It is having three layers, two layers of sand and the third layer is of clay. And the gamma values are different for each layer. The depth of each layer is varying. So you can see the figure. GWT, ground water table, is also marked. It is at the chart of the clay layer. Okay, so we have to consider a total stress and the pore water pressure in order to find out the effective stress. So the figure of effective stress is given at the middle. Doesn't mind. So we are first finding the total stress. So look at the left hand side figure. Total stress, a triangle is shown. So what is the total stress we are finding? We are considering four points A, B, C and D. A is at the topmost layer, B is at the bottom of the sand, first sand layer, then C is at the bottom of second sand layer and D is at the bottom of the clay layer. So A, B, C and D are considered. So what is the stress value at the point A? It is 0. Nothing is above it. So the value is 0. Total stress is 0. Now what about point B? At point B, it is retaining or it is having something of sand layer of depth H1. So at the value gamma 1, we can denote it like gamma 1. So we are just representing it. So gamma 1 into H1 will be the total stress at the point B. Then at point C, what will be the total stress? Gamma 1 into H1 plus gamma 2 into H2. Here H1 value is 1.8 and H2 is 1.6. So we are just having a representation of the problem or a hint. Discussing the hint of the problem, we'll be doing more numericals later. Then at the point D, what will be the value of total stress? It will be gamma 1 into H1 plus gamma 2 into H2 plus gamma 3 into H3. So we have considered all the three layers. Now where this difference comes? Difference comes with the groundwater table level. So if groundwater table level is coming, this gamma value, the value will be changing, like gamma submerged will be coming. Clear? So if you are looking the pore water pressure, what will be the pore water pressure? So the layers, first and second layer is not having water table, only the third layer is experiencing the effect of water table. So look at the right hand side of the figure. Pore water pressure at a depth at the level of D, what will be the pore water pressure? It is gamma W into HW. Height of water is here 2.9 because groundwater table is marked at the top of the clay layer. So the height is 2.9 meter. Clear? Gamma W into HW. So if you are finding the effective stress at the bottommost layer, some difference will be coming. Clear? So what will be the effective stress? Now we are finding the effective stress. It is given in the middle. If you are drawing a stress variation diagram, effective stress. There is no pore water pressure at the layers of A, B and C. So their total stress will be the same. Effective stress and total stress will be the same. So what about the layer at the level of D? If you are considering point D, there is pore water pressure coming. So if you are taking gamma 1 into H1 plus gamma 2 into H2 plus gamma 3, there comes the difference. So H3 value, H3 is a height 2.9 meter. So this 2.9 meter is affected by the groundwater table. So the gamma value is gamma 3 H3 and gamma W HW. So there comes a difference. And there comes gamma submerged. Gamma 1 into H1 plus gamma 2 into H2 plus gamma submerged into H3. Because total effective stress is equal to total stress minus pore water pressure. As in the previous slide, we have to take gamma saturated minus gamma W, which is equal to gamma submerged. So When you get a problem, you have to check whether where the groundwater table is coming, water table is coming, and we have to take the gamma value accordingly.